grant of all alcohol on-premise license proposal.
I move we open a public hearing for the grant of all alcohol license for Pepper's Bar and Grill at 321 Great Road.
Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Caroline to open the public hearing. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, 500. Petitioner? Hi. Mr. Morris? So tell us about the plan.
I'm going to bring to Bedford something that I have similar in New York for 8 years. We're going to do, say, Neapolitan pizzas, pasta dinners, you know, do some fish, going to do breakfast on weekends, which the town is missing now. So, you know, we want to be a comfortable, casual place that, you know, kind of no pretenses. People can come in and just feel comfortable, have a nice affordable meal, you know, come out and visit on a regular basis.
And any particular reason why you're moving up from Maynard?
Well, I have an offer at my restaurant in Maynard. I felt that it had reached its potential of where it was going to go. I lived in Bedford for 41 years.
Really?
And I wanted to, you know, come back, you know, eventually move back into the area. So it's kind of always been, you know, back in my mind to get back, you know, to town. So, you know, my daughters have grown up here. Still have one in the school system. And I have two younger children that I'd like to get into the school system as well. So it's just a natural move where, you know, I've kind of grown up in the town, feel very comfortable, and I guess it's a pizza maker.
What was the location of Maynard, right downtown?
Right down Main Street.
Maynard used to be quite a destination for food. I guess it still is.
Yeah, it still is. You know, they're going through some growing and some changes, and where digital used to be, was the owner of the property, and they're going to put actually a pub brewery in there, and I think some condominiums, and they actually have a new complex, retail complex they want to build also.
And the old clock tower.
Yeah.
Questions from Selectmen?
Just have one regarding the location of Maynard. Did you have a all liquor license there? Beer and wine there?
Yep.
Okay.
Did the building inspector comment that he couldn't match the layout with the number of seats? Can you clarify?
Yeah, it was just a couple of seats difference. What we did is we had one means of egress, and so to not run into any issues, we shrunk the kitchen and add the second means of egress. So this way here, you know, there will be no issues about it.
So the total number is 47?
47, right.
Okay. I brought this up when we had a previous applicant. Bedford doesn't tend to like to use the word bar. And I'm hoping you'd be willing to consider amending your name of your restaurant to whatever you want, but not include the word bar. Pepper's Grill, or just Pepper's, or anything you choose. Do you have any real trouble with doing that?
No, the only reason I put it in is because I just wanted to let people know that, you know, we do serve, you know,
I understand.
As far as with the grill, with food. And, you know, the emphasis is on the food. That's why the seats greatly outnumber, you know, the size,
yep,
you know, of the bar. So, you know, I wouldn't have any, you know.
You have a preference?
As far as the name?
Mm-hmm.
Well, a lot of people, it was funny because, you know, my restaurant name was named Roasted Peppers because I wanted to do something different. I didn't want to say Jim's Cafe on Main Street.
No, of course not.
But everybody ended up always calling it Pepper. So let's go down to, you know, Peppers, or, you know, we'll see Jim Pepper. Or, you know, so I almost named it that. so that's why I figured, well, you know, we can go with Peppers. There's enough of a differentiation. So I assume it's going to get cut by most people anyways.
So just call it Pepper?
Yeah, I think I would just go.
Okay, if you don't mind.
Okay.
That works in with Bedford better. Thank you.
Well, I just want to clarify Bill's point. Bill, I think what we asked last time had nothing to do with the name of the restaurant. It simply had to do with the sign.
That's true.
So that if a sign on the outside simply says Peppers, you can call it and do business in any way you'd like. It's, I think Bill's point was just.
I stand corrected.
We just didn't want people driving by and seeing a sign that says bar.
Oh, yeah.
So.
I spoke to the landlord, and I know you're probably familiar with the signage, but they don't have any real plans of altering the sign out on the road right now. So right now, I think it's just gonna be Home Goods, TJ Maxx, I think the Great Wall, and Ocean State Job Lot. So they really don't have any room to add hours, so.
But will you?
My sign would just be right on the face.
Right, I was gonna say, you'll have your own sign there, yeah.
Right, yeah.
People will find you.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, I mean, it's a small enough town, there's people always, you know, you're gonna have this, you're gonna have, it's been quite a bit of buzz.
Sure.
You know, that way, and I think if you have a good product and a good service, people will find you, they'll know where you are, and, especially, I think, for breakfast too, all the DPW guys are very happy about that.
And from Lexington.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's your timetable?
As far as opening? The contract is being put out to bid for the demolition, right now, as far as, you know, prices from the different, contractors. So I assume that in the next week or two, they should have that straightened out. So, they told me about 30 days they need for demolition and to finish the inside, and then my contract is in charge of the finish work. So they're gonna leave me a vanilla box, the landlord's gonna leave me the vanilla box with HVAC, plumbing, and electrical, and then we'll go in and finish it, you know, the seating and the kitchen and everything. So I'm hoping the end of July, beginning of August, it'll be operational. The sooner the better for me, I'm ready to get going.
Other questions?
Just out of curiosity, are you bringing some of your staff from the?
Some, yeah, I've already contacted, you know, a few of them, and they're all, you know, ready to get going with me. They liked the way that I ran the restaurant, you know, we had a great working relationship. So I have a few people that have expressed interest to come back.
Great.
But, you know, I'm looking probably, you know, hiring anywhere from 12 to 20 people to cover, you know, shifts throughout the week, so there'll still be quite a bit of, you know, local people that will have the opportunity to work as well, and hopefully we can hire more and be busy.
Good, great, thank you.
It's a public hearing, so we invite, entertain any comments from the public.
The only other comment we have, Mike, in the record here is just, not releasing the liquor license until there's a valid certificate of occupancy. That's just coming from code. Code wants to make sure you have an occupancy permit before we actually provide the liquor license.
We have, I believe, one alcohol license from our original allocation, plus we have 8 new ones that have been approved through the state process, and there is a difference in, under the legislation that approved the 8 new ones, those licenses are not transferable. So there's a difference in terms of what we have and the new batch. I don't know if it has any practical implications. I was trying to think of whether we ever had a transfer in recent years.
Yeah, we voted one out on Middlesex Turnpike. I mean, names changes.
No, but the limit is the location. I believe the issue is transferring location.
Oh, location.
And not you know,
did,
not just.
Did we end up resolving whether or not the hopscotching around the new marketplace was a change of location or not a change of location? We didn't think it would be, but we didn't know whether the ABCC would consider that the strict address was different.
They've approved all of them.
Okay.
And of course, in all those cases, transfers were permitted anyway.
Right.
So it wasn't an issue either way, in a sense.
Yeah.
Oh, they just went.
But you're right. I don't think.
If you want to, depending on how you want to do accounting, whether it's last in, first out, or the other way around, the Plaza Hotel is a transfer. If you want to say this is the Plaza Hotel, it's a transfer.
That's true.
Or if the first one we gave away was the Plaza, it was a transfer.
But you're right. That's the only location, real location change, because that license is no longer at that location. But it does seem rare.
I personally think that we ought to give one of the new ones here. I think like the size of the operation and the location are such that, that this would be a perfect place to use one of the new ones. And we, if a larger organization, another Red Heat or something came along, that would be a better type of organization to give the remaining existing population-driven license.
I don't follow. I mean, they seem like six one, half a dozen the other.
It's, and I guess my concern would be any prior conversations that have gone on and given the indication that this is the license that came from, or is the old type. You know, there's probably arrangements and deals and conversations and contracts that have been made with that in mind. So I somewhat disagree that we should change and use one of the new ones and hold the old for the what if.
Entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Move to close the public hearing.
Second.
Moved by Mark, seconded by Caroline to close the public hearing. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500. So, public hearing is closed. Ready for the motion?
I move that the Selectmen approve the request for an all alcohol license for Mina LLC doing business as Pepper's Bar and Grill at 321 Great Road, pending the proof. Pending proof that a valid certificate of occupancy has been issued.
Second.
Moved by Carolyn.
Before we vote on this, is there a way to designate which of the liquor licenses this is?
I think unless you state that it's under special legislation granted to the town of Bedford, then it would be deemed to be through the quota system.
Okay. And that's what you intended,
That's what I intended, yeah.
So it's moved by Caroline, seconded by Margon. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? 500. Might as well stay here. We have a common victualer's application for Mina doing business at Pepper's Bar and Grill.
So this is basically a prospective request because, of course, you haven't built out your space yet. So then there's no indication from health or from code. So I just think we need to make it consistent and be contingent upon health and code approvals. Other than that, I don't think there's an issue. There was no point in granting you a liquor license and not letting you run a restaurant.
I did.
Right. Yes. Yes, exactly.
I did just want to make a comment that the hours, I think, are what Bedford is missing. And so, you know, there's a deliberate pattern in the opening early on the weekends and closing a little bit on Sunday for you and your life. For you and your life is just made note that I thought that was a thoughtful way to do your hours.
What time does it say for Sunday? 6 to 1?
6 to 1, yeah. Breakfast, brunch?
Oh, 6 a.m.
Yes.
Not 6 p.m. I would just call your attention, if you're not familiar with it, the Healthy Bedford Healthy Dining Program. And it sort of hasn't been so active lately because we've seen a lot of turnover in our restaurant offerings in town. But generally, it's to encourage restaurateurs to offer healthy options to people and to publicize them and give opportunities to sort of tout their healthy options. So I always just bring that up to our new restaurateurs to let you know that that's something that the town cares about, and there may be opportunities for you to work with the town around healthy dining options.
Yeah, I'm the type of person, I like to give a quality product. You can always find less expensive things, but like, for example, I use a flour imported from Italy. It's about 50% more expensive than regular flour, but to me, it's a better option. So I take a little bit of a hit on the bottom line because I'm giving out quality product. So everything that I buy, that I serve, is all quality items, things that I would serve to my family and to anybody else. So I don't like going, you know, the less expensive route just for the sake of a profit margin. So even if it comes down to healthier things and they're better for you, then we're going to have people more often that way. And we build the business on frequency rather than just a short-term profit. Mm-hmm. So I would the end of the day, I like to know that I'm getting a quality product, and I go home and I'm not feeling good about it.
Any other questions or comments? Ready for motion?
Well, I do have one question, or I just, do we need to, is it clear about the signage then? I just want to make sure whether we need to put that as part of a motion or whether.
I'm fine.
You're fine with it, this Peppers or anything doesn't have the word bar in it?
Okay.
Okay, and I'm ready for a motion. I move that the Selectmen approve a common victor's license for Mina LLC doing business as Peppers, operating at 321 Great Road.
Second.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Mark. So we don't need the provision about the certificate of occupancy.
Conditional on.
Yeah.
I heard, that's what I heard you say.
I did, subject to Board of Health and Code Enforcement.
We already covered that on the, they don't get a license without it.
I think it makes sense for the common victor.
I'll add the words conditional on getting certificate of occupancy.
Well, and
Board of Health.
Approval from Board of Health.
Board of Health, yeah.
They'll have to inspect, yeah.
Nothing you weren't going to do anyway.
Right, exactly.
I'd like to get along with everybody.
Hey, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, 500.
Welcome back to Bedford.
Yeah, we're looking forward to it.
Good luck.
We'll look forward to your opening.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to working, actually. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, we've been asked to award the proposed 3-year contract for Recreation Department bus services. Mr. Reed, did you want to have any introduction for the, seems like we do this periodically.
Yes, so Mr. Chair, members of the board, this is a contract for providing the Recreation Department busing services for their programs that they operate throughout the year. The contract is bid out on a unit price basis, estimating a number of trips that it would have in the course of the year. The bids were advertised in the local newspaper, and only one bid was received from Bedford Charter Service. Staff recommends your approval of the contract.
Is this the same company that provided it last time?
They have provided it for the last 2 contract periods.
So it looks like the only change from year to year is in the ski trip.
Yeah, I wondered about that as well. If there was a particular reason that that one, and not others, I mean.
No snow this last winter.
Well, it's for next year, right?
I mean, it probably comes out to about $1 a passenger.
They're probably the longer duration trips. So that may have something to do with it.
I'm sorry, what, so is the ski trip is different?
Yes, the only one that's different between 2016 and 2017, all the other prices stay the same.
Oh, okay.
Any questions?
Rick, you have a copy that's approved as deformed by town council? Ours just doesn't happen to be the signed version, I'm assuming you had it, just didn't get copied for us.
I know we did submit it to the town council to have him review it, and he approved it as to form. We may not have the signatures on that yet. We'll just, we have to, it's on a separate page, so we'll just have to put the sign. Sorry, I was looking at the wrong set of contracts. Yes, we'll have to get them signed, but he did email us telling us he approved it as the.
I appreciated the little synopsis of the history of Bedford Charter that was included. I don't remember seeing that before. Old timers like me remember when that site was the DPW garage. So, ready for the motion?
Move the Selectmen approve a contract is the, between the town of Bedford and the Bedford Charter Service for providing transportation for Recreation Department. Transportation needs for a term from July 1st, 2016 to June 30th, 2019.
Second.
By Bill, seconded by Caroline. All those in favor of approving the contract?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, 500. We have another contract for sewer manhole rehabilitation work in connection with prevention of inflow and infiltration.
Hello.
So the sewer manhole repairs, variety of different methods will be used in the field, basically to address inflow and infiltration that was discovered a year ago in our smoke testing contract. The deficiencies where maybe the manhole on the inside is leaking, the roof penetration, or maybe the manhole, the cover, the casting, the ground part that sits on top of the concrete section, maybe they have a leak around it. So there's various methods that you see in the contract where the contractor will come in, perform the inspections, and then a year from now, so it goes through a cycle, the repairs are inspected again, and then the credit is given to NWRA, which will in turn hopefully reduce our sewer charges in the future. HICAMP has worked for the town on various projects under a different name. They combined a couple of firms together, and we've always been very pleased with their work. Contract is funded from a 4555 NWRA loan grant program.
Maybe addressing all these locations as shown on these maps?
Yes.
And is this just, I know this is not, I forget the words you use here, this is just inflow, not, it's one or the other. It's not seepage into the pipes, it's just strictly the manholes.
It's just basically the manholes. There's a short section of pipe that's near a manhole that's going to be root treated, and that section will also be root treated. So there's no pipe liners.
And when this is done, will we then, in theory, have done all the manholes in town, or just, is this an ongoing thing?
It's an ongoing thing.
Like in perpetuity, you know, forever working our way around? I just wanted to understand the process, not...
We have another section of town. So when we started our II work, we basically started in the older sections of town where there's clay pipe. Clay sections come in very short pieces, so you have that many more joints, so you can have that many more opportunities for II. So basically we've repaired all our clay sections, and now we're working in the sections where there's different pipe materials. Some of this is asbestos AC pipe, some of this is PVC pipe. But again, you're looking at your manholes that over time will just continue to get penetrations or root leakage, or the cement that holds the casting to the manhole, becomes brittle and
freeze and thaw.
So you have to do a smoke study every time and then a correction?
Smoke study is good for about 10 years.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. These repairs will be good for about 10 years.
How many manholes are in town? I mean, out of 100, you said 116, this is going to be the beginning of, just roughly to put it in perspective.
100.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the problem is that we have to pay for the info. That's a, think about it, 160,000 gallons per day that we get charged.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's a lot.
We charge, but we also have to move it so we get pump.
So that's electricity.
Right. There's a savings immediately, and then there's a savings in our 3-year annual running average of sewer rates.
Mm-hmm.
Also, we just want to mention for the board that we did receive 3 bids. This was the lowest bid, and the other bids were $137,975.50 and $150,080 even.
So we'll see another request like this next year and every year, in effect?
Coming think in the future we're gonna be concentrating on our sewer mains, our force mains, evaluation we just got received funding for. So we might not be doing II this time next year, another sewer.
And in recent years, if I remember, the emphasis has been on illegal connections from roof drains and basements and residences that suddenly discover a smoke-filled house from. Whoa, where'd that come from?
No back check, Phil.
All right, so, ready for the motion on this, when are they gonna start? They have to wait until, they have to coordinate with paving schedules at all? Any resurfacing?
No, most of this work, again, is internal. They probably will be starting, 2-3 weeks out.
Well, I'll move the Selectmen approve contract with Height Camp Incorporated in the amount of $108,470 for Phase 3 sewer manhole rehabilitation.
Seven.
Yeah. Thank you. 108,407.
Second.
Moved by Hargard, seconded by Phil to approve the contract with, Height Camp Inc. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, 500. Now we have, materials and services, the annual,
Lots to sign, right?
Let me start off by asking about the, what happens when, with the categories where there was no award that need to be rebid. Is that because, is that a uniform thing where there weren't?
We did not receive bids for number 10, athletic field paint, and number 20, catch basin repair, and 23, roadway crack zone, so we are rebidding those. There was one, bid number 9, the, bid to supply the gasoline and diesel fuel for the town. One bidder has not filed a formal protest, but is, protesting or questioning why we have chosen to award the contract to one bidder rather than two bidders. We take the separate differential, there was a low bidder for one, one had a low bid for fuel, and one had a low bid for diesel. Town council has re-reviewed the spec and said that we were correct in saying that we would bid, combined as the volumes that we would be purchasing, times the differential, and that unit that final total cost is what we're going to be basing it on. So we didn't have time to put that in the back, but that'll come back. So we'll do the other ones.
But that issue has been settled through council. Yeah, that's kind of an important one.
So for the most part, there are, vendors here, contracts here, who we're very familiar with. There's only one or two that will be new to us. The sodium hypochlorite from Pure Pool Services is a new vendor, although we're familiar with them on a different, product. And the, other one is the handwork under number 18, handwork with trench patch. It's a new bid for us, and Big Pond, who has not worked, hasn't worked for the town in a couple, maybe 20, 30 years, with the low, apparent low bid for that. But everybody else is a repeat, vendor for us. And these are for 2-year contracts, fiscal 17 and fiscal 18.
Now, are we required to accept the low bid in every case?
As long as it's qualified there, yeah.
Other questions about, the materials and services for the coming year?
Just to make sure I'm reading this correctly, for instance, under tree services, we have one company for routine and another company for emergency.
Correct.
And on the first page, the under water quality testing, we don't have any response for the first two lines, but we do for the third.
I think it's all the same.
And not for the fourth, or is it the same?
It is the same.
All of them are covered by that
The only difference is the GTHMs and the HA5s are going to be awarded to that Microvac Laboratories.
And
the one, two, those other four lines are going to be awarded.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I understood what it's about. That's what I assumed. So how do we need to do this motion, Rick? Do we need to name every company or?
How about a motion to recommend approval as contracts, of contracts for annual materials and services bids as recommended in the letter from Adrian St. John dated May 12th, 2016.
I think that's what I just moved.
Second.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Caroline to accept the material and service bids as presented in the memorandum. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, 5-0-0. We can do business now.
Thank you for the nice memo.
Chapter 90 project request, road resurfacing for the coming season.
So we have two neighborhoods that we will be reconstructing this summer that we would like to use chapter 90 funds. Investment program through the master of all the work is will be eligible, including some drainage repairs. And they're going, the roads will be reclaimed, and we're going to pulverize them into a gravel subbase. We'll grade it and pave it in two courses to bind them up. Even items such as silt sacks and grease details. Though there's no striping in these, neighborhoods, striping would also have been eligible for chapter 90.
Any sidewalks as part of this?
Not in here, no.
And how does this fit in with complete streets?
Well, these are both neighborhoods that are localized neighborhoods.
Sort of self-contained.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I mean, no,
right, Holton, Caribou, Masardis, those are all up off of the Great Road with no access, right? So they're essentially neighborhood streets with
just
very low traffic volume. Yeah. So.
Occasionally somebody tries to take Elmbrook Road straight through. Yeah. Once.
From the road to the circle?
Mm-hmm.
The street that seems to be missing is Jonathan Lane. But maybe that's part of the Brooksby neighborhood.
That is back there, but off of Elmbrook.
That's
oh, that's not between them.
That's
it's on the other side. Gotcha.
So. You guys do Pine Knoll Road, the Bedford
part? The one lot, yes.
That's not on here. Maybe it has a different address. I was talking to someone yesterday at the Diversity Festival who lives on Pine Knoll Road in Lexington, and I told her that she had to leave. Intertown relationship. Any other questions on the Chapter 90 project?
You know, I just,
Bill?
I'd like to go back to this complete streets because I thought what was said, and maybe Margaret, you could comment on this, that any time we did significant rehabbing of roads, which is what we're going to do here, we would address sidewalks. So how's this decision get made, to do them or not to do them?
So there's a prioritized sidewalk list that the Transportation Advisory Committee has been reviewing over the course of many years. Generally, the sidewalks that are recommended for construction are creating or expanding our sidewalk network and allowing people to get onto arterials and along arterials. Generally, within new developments, the developer will put in sidewalks as part of the project.
Yeah.
And in the cases of cul-de-sacs or self-contained neighborhoods, generally the value of adding the sidewalk there is relatively minimal because people are safe and comfortable traversing those streets without the sidewalks. And so in none of these cases is any of these roads on that list, as far as I'm aware, of the prioritized sidewalk, and nor do any of these roads appear on the bike ped master plan.
Okay. I was interpreting a more encompassing
I think the point of the complete streets policy is to, well, first of all, prompt the question of whether or not it would be appropriate to build sidewalks when we use our Chapter 90 funds, and I appreciate the question very much, actually, Bill. But also to help implement the list of prioritized projects that we have declared and will be telling the state that we intend to do with our Chapter 90 funds. So certainly the next time the Chapter 90 fund request comes up in an area that has a sensitive project, then that would be included.
The other thing is that this is more maintenance than anything else, right?
Well, you said grinding, and I mean, this is rather significant replacing, isn't it?
It's resurfacing?
It's more than just
resurfacing. Grinding it into a gravel subbase, okay. Because you really can't overlay the roads that are in this condition right now.
Mm-hmm.
Grinding it, re-graveling it, paving.
And how, I'm sorry if this is in here, how is that done specifically in a self-contained neighborhood to allow traffic to come? So I'm just in my head, I was just thinking about Masardis and Holton going up to that, you know, the three streets. So did you do a half of the road or one road and detour back through?
So the equipment will move through the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
There's about a couple hour period where the reclaimer has gone through pulverized material, but the grader follows right behind. Mm-hmm. So there's only about a 2 hour window where you couldn't drive on the road. Because at the end of the day, the roads are all opened up.
Sure.
The neighbors can
sure.
And these neighborhoods actually have two and actually furnishes three areas to get in.
Sure.
So there'll be, you know, sections of roadway where will be blocked off for an hour or two as the machine works its way through.
Okay. And what's the time frame? When are you doing this?
Probably the second week of June.
Okay.
For Lexington Park.
Mm-hmm.
You may have seen a notice that the gas company has planned to replace the gas main on Elmbrook Road, Elmbrook Circle, and Cedar Ridge Drive. So although we were going to start there, we've now put our schedule to start at Lexington Park, so the gas company can work June and July in the Elmbrook area.
Mr. Cohen.
Wow. You don't know where you are?
Oh.
It's like lavender.
Lavender.
I guess a minor note. I feel on the second, on the last page where a chart is, we're going way ahead in time. There are a couple of references to 2107 as opposed to 2017.
Oh.
Probably just want to.
Yeah, it's a little beyond our lifetime.
Yep.
There are two of them, I think, in the same. The two boxes next to each other.
Okay,
I'd hate to have people think those will be another 100 years before anybody comes back.
Yeah, really.
Hey. Thanks for the motion on the Chapter 90 project request.
I'll move the Selectmen approve the expenditure of $350,000 of Chapter 90 funds for Elmbrook Road, Elmbrook Circle, Cedar Ridge Drive, and Cedar Ridge Terrace, and further approve $425,000 for Chapter 90 funds for Holton Street, Caribou Street, Asardis, Parham, Madawaska, Woodland Road, and Sibley Drive.
Second.
Moved by Margot, seconded by Mark. In the Chapter 90 resurfacing projects, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500. Good.
Thank you.
Everybody will be busy. We have a few proposed waivers for appointments to recreation positions.
You usually do these, Mike.
Yeah, well.
Okay, I'll jump in. I'm jumping in here.
Yeah, I wanted to really leave
right,
something
Hannah,
to be remembered.
Oh, you'll be remembered.
He used to do the Chapter 268A's.
So
Are you gonna do it, or do you wanna?
Well, no, I guess you can, because I don't know if we can do it all together or not, so I'll listen to you.
We can. I'll move we grant approval exemption under 268A, section 20B for Parker Taggart, Brendan Kilroy, Hannah Kilroy, and Jacqueline, Bamashi.
Second.
Moved by Mark and seconded by Margaret to approve five exemptions under 268A. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
There's four.
Four, yeah.
Aye.
500. Sorry. Moving right along, we have three sets of minutes.
30 sets of signatures.
We'll still be signing. Meeting will be over. We'll still be signing.
Starting with, which one do you want to start with?
Starting with March 29th.
29th.
I didn't have any.
I just have one editorial correction on page 3, under 16228. The one that starts out, Ms. Fleischman made a motion, is said twice. So one of those made a motion should be deleted. Other than that, I'm happy. And would move that we accept the minutes of Tuesday, March 29th.
Second.
As amended.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Margaret. All those in favor of approving the minutes of March 29th?
Aye.
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 500, regular session, April 11th.
Oh, just page 2. To be absolutely proper, it's second paragraph, it's Historic District Commission, where the word committee appears twice in there. And on page 5, down under the second last paragraph, Mr. Moonen moved, it says the motion passed, it's actually the amendment passed. The next paragraph says the motion passed. So this is an amendment, not a motion.
Any other corrections or questions?
I have just one very small one on page 3, towards the bottom, where we're talking about the cost for various pool options. I just like to add the approximate cost or the estimated cost. Those aren't the costs.
Mm-hmm.
We never got that far.
On page 4, I just have a clarification about complete streets discussion. In the second paragraph, Ms. Fleischman raised some questions about the language in the policy. There's a reference to the Bicycle Pedestrian Master Plan Steering Committee, mm-hmm. add the word steering. And I would add, instead of the second sentence, I'd say, this is a staff working group and not a committee, period. And then it was agreed that this role could be taken by the Transportation Advisory Committee. And then on page 5, the last paragraph of that same discussion, finally, Ms. Fleischman suggested that the edited version be returned to the Transportation Advisory Committee to make sure they were able to take on responsibility for reviewing the policy. And I think that's all for me.
I'd just like to make two adjustments to the list of attendees on the first page. Down near the bottom, Tom Mulligan, he's also a member of the Recreation Commission. And after that, Jim O'Neill is also a member of Capital Expenditure Committee. They are residents, but as long as we're doing affiliations. Ready for the motion?
I move that we approve the minutes of Monday, April 11th as amended. Second.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Caroline. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500. April 11th, executive session.
I don't have anything.
I move we accept the minutes of executive session of April 11th as written.
Second.
Moved by Bill, seconded by Caroline. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 500.
Bill. I didn't sign.
I forgot something.
Okay, manager's report.
So last meeting, the Selectmen asked to have staff do a little bit more about educating the town and our, probably our state officials about the expiring use aspect of Bedford Village apartment complex. So we did draft a letter. I think you have a copy of the draft in the package, and we have final copies if you would like us to go ahead and consider having those approved for signature tonight. One for State Senator Barrett and one for State Representative Gordon. But I think the letter outlines pretty comprehensively what the issues are. So in a sense, those letters can be used for you, yourselves, to be able to speak to people about it and talk to the community in general about what the issues are.
One of the things that surprised me, and I must have just missed it somewhere, is when this project was built, 25% of those units were market. Do you remember when that changed?
I don't.
But they're 100% subsidizing.
Yeah.
Do we know what the status of this bill is, the House 4136?
No.
Okay.
Mike, I think part of what you're asking has to do with the fact that there are now residents who are holding vouchers, so that the units could be market rate units, except for the fact that the tenants that happen to have been accepted by the owners, which is perfectly appropriate, happen to have mobile vouchers and can go to any unit anywhere. Mm-hmm. So on paper, they may still be market rate units, but the tenants have vouchers that assist them with the difference between what their income allows and what the market rate would be. So that may be the shift that makes it, that it is a little confusing. The two charts, you know, lay out two different scenarios. One is the reality of who's in the building, and one is the structure that it originally had. But that may be where that your question lies, somewhere along the line. Mobile voucher holders were able to then come and find vacancies and be able to move in.
That 25%, though, if this program ends, still remains 25%.
Right? The
low income
remains. Low income.
The affordable remains, quote, affordable.
That's what it said, right?
That's what it says. Just want to make sure I didn't misunderstand. I think it's a good letter, and do we need to move to authorize the chair to sign on behalf of the selectmen?
I think we all sign it.
We can all sign
it? Have it prepared for you all to sign it.
Okay.
So we don't need a motion?
No.
Okay, we just sign.
Yeah, this is, thank you for being vigilant about the time.
Yep.
The only other thing I just wanted to mention tonight is for future planning purposes. I'm starting to think about the fall schedule, and this year, because of the election day falls on the second Tuesday of November, November 8th, it probably doesn't make sense for us to try to schedule a town meeting on Monday, November 7th. Tradition has been to have usually around the first Monday of November as a special town meeting. The previous Monday is October 31st, and I don't think that would be a good night to hold a special town meeting.
No, it might be very appropriate, actually.
So the two dates I'm interested in hearing your feedback on are November 1st and November 2nd. I did discuss it briefly with the moderator over the weekend, and I think she's okay with either date. There is a Catholic religious holiday on November 1st, so I think if November 2nd doesn't present a challenge with anybody, that Wednesday would be a good day to pick.
So it's November 2nd is the Tuesday?
It's a Wednesday.
Oh, it's a Wednesday. Oh, right, yeah. It's a Wednesday.
So how many would be on a Wednesday?
The interesting change.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's
no reason I can't, yeah. And fine with me.
Sure.
Okay, so we'll talk to a few other people and use that as a planning date. Bill, it looks like you want to sign some more things.
I've got carpal tunnel going here.
More?
That's it.
Open discussion on Selectmen's liaison reports, Bill?
Well, reporting on attending things, just so all of you understand what's going on, the Historic District Commission has attracted a huge crowd. The Unitarian Church is in a mode to try to get as much off the grid as they can. They're doing all sorts of things to make the building more energy tight and to be more self-sufficient. HDC in previous meetings had approved storm windows and putting a vault underground, which you may see the digging going on the Elm Street side, that will allow heat pumps and other equipment to be put below grade and not highly visible. The most controversial thing, though, has drawn many of the parishioners to our meetings and will probably cause us to have the next meeting in the multipurpose room, is the desire to put solar collectors on the roof over the sanctuary and the new section in the back on the Maple Street side and on the South Street, South Road side of the church. This is one of the very oldest buildings in town and one of the most iconic buildings, and has the dubious pleasure of being surrounded by fully usable public ways that the entire building can be seen. The parishioners understandably feel that this is an important thing to do. They feel it's important to help reduce the carbon footprint of the church, and it obviously will have some financial benefits to them in terms of running the building. There is great concern about the impact of these solar panels visually in the Historic District, and the Historic District Commission's requirement to consider each building alone and its impact on the district. And so the discussion about these has been spread over two meetings so far, and there'll be a third one on June 1st. And the discussion will continue. I just thought you all should know that was going on. And I guess I noted a letter to the editor in the Citizen about the access of cars to the park, to the post office, and or the lack thereof. And I don't know that there's really anything the selectmen really can do about that, because it is private property. But I have to say that in theory, you're supposed to go in one side and come out the other if you're driving into park or to post mail, and because of demand at the red heat, there frequently is no way to get out of that place except the way you came in. And if a truck comes in, as the letter writer to the Citizen indicated, you are stuck until that truck moves. I don't know if anybody else had, I thought maybe we could write a letter to the landlord and suggest that he resolve the problem in the interest of the public, or?
What can we do? I'd love to be able to be aggressive about this. Entertain any thoughts.
Is it a temporary problem? Because I have heard of this, but I guess I keep thinking that it's going to go away.
It's not temporary as long as they've got big containers at mm-hmm. one end, which was originally supposed to be where the exit was. And there's parking all along between the entrance into the post office area and those containers. Now, if that parking were unstriped and indicated as an exit,
So I guess my question or suggestion might be, it's still an active construction zone.
Yep.
And presumably, there's some oversight in terms of the building inspector, in terms of the conduct of the equipment. I don't know if they have any way of making suggestions about where they're staging things and creating safe egress for people on the site, because it's both an active shopping center and an active construction zone. I mean, in the issues of public interest of public safety, does the building inspector have any right to tell the property owner how to arrange the egress on the property during construction?
I don't know the answer to that question, but regardless of the answer, we'll ask him to talk to the landlord.
That would be fabulous.
But beyond that, that's an embarrassment for a post office. I mean,
Well, the issue with the post office is,
yeah.
I mean, I think that's the essential problem, is that there's no successor location for the post office.
I think from talking to them, I've heard they have resolved a place to go within the shopping center, but it won't be available to them until at least September.
Oh, well, that's good news anyway.
At least that's what I understood, but that's secondhand.
I heard from one of the post office people that they have a location, they just don't know when.
Yeah.
Okay. It will be in the market.
At least fall.
Well, that's good. But it's true, because people are accessing those little temporary post office facilities on foot, on bicycle, in car, older people trying to negotiate difficult turns, and then this issue of...
Sorry.
That's okay.
There was a day when, in fact, it said do not enter in both directions. So
before the holidays.
It was crazy. Right. You couldn't figure out how to drive in there at all. So I do think if we could talk to them, if there's got to be a way to sign it and make sure people know that there's supposed to be some real circulation and you can't just park in the exit lane at the far end.
Took two of the parking spaces that are closest to the container. Make them look like parking spaces. Yeah.
So, well, when they first did it, there was a sign that said exit, and you could tell you were supposed to go around. They haven't kept up with it, and they just need to do it.
It went between the containers, and since then they've moved equipment in there. Yes, having the building inspector is an excellent idea as a first step. Other than that, I'm done. Thanks
for bringing that up. That's good to know there's a light at the end of that tunnel. Carolyn?
I don't have any reports. I just had a quick question. Are we set on the goal setting session on June 22nd, and did we decide on hours for that? Did we? I thought we talked about putting it onto a meeting. Okay.
5:30.
That's what I heard.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
a freestanding date that doesn't have a meeting.
Yes.
And if we need extras,
then subsequently.
Yep. Mm-hmm. All right. That's all. I just had a quick question.
Well, the only issue that I wanted to bring to everyone's attention was something that happened recently at the ZBA. And it was an interpretation of our zoning bylaws relative to the construction of two families. So there was a property that the developer wanted to redevelop an existing property that had an existing structure on it into a two-family and had the required lot size that our zoning laws require in order to do so. But the interpretation that our building inspector had relative to the bylaws was that our bylaws were intended to refer to vacant property and not the redevelopment of an existing structure into a two-family. And I believe he sought out town council's opinion and some other advice from people who were involved in the drafting of that bylaw, and it was the consensus was that that was, in fact, what the bylaw was meant to say. I just wanted to bring it to your attention, though, because as Bedford continues to be built out, and if that is the correct legal interpretation of our bylaw, what it may actually mean is that there are very few places where we could build two families. And in the sense that we're looking for opportunities for diverse housing stock and opportunities for infill of existing neighborhoods rather than perhaps, old houses being torn down or new houses being built on virgin properties. I just wanted to bring to your attention that at some point, we might want to look and see if that is the correct interpretation of our bylaw as it was intended. Are there, in fact, any sites left in Bedford where you could build a two-family? And is that what we want, or do we want to look at that again and to think about either encouraging or discouraging two-family homes? But at any rate, we may actually get to the position where we have a bylaw that is essentially meaningless because if there are no vacant lots on which to build two families, then there will be no two families in Bedford.
No additional.
No additional.
Right, exactly, no additional two families.
Who is it, or what organization is it that should start pursuing that? The planning department, or?
Well, I think it's a discussion that has to be had across a bunch of different boards.
Housing department.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it came up in this particular instance because there was a difference of opinion between the, in the interpretation of the bylaw between the developer and the town. And it seems as though, at least for the moment, that's been resolved, although maybe it will get appealed, I don't know. But I just wanted you to know that that had occurred, and that for me personally, it does raise that question of whether or not it makes sense to have a two-family, a law regulating the construction of two families that has no practical application.
Well, I attended the first hearing on that matter. I didn't attend the follow-up. And just so you know, I recall the applicant mentioning that it was under the advice of counsel that he sought before he purchased the property, mm-hmm. to see if he could actually build a two-family. His legal counsel told him, advised him, after reviewing the bylaw, that, you know, it's new construction. You know, the intent wasn't clearly stipulated. And you either be renovating an existing structure, or you're providing new construction. I happen to disagree with the building inspector's interpretation on that one, but, you know, it was,
yeah.
You know, so this person purchased the property with that understanding, and then,
I mean, at
what that plan B is, but.
At very least, it may be incumbent upon the town, if we wish to continue that, to propose that version of it where it is a vacant lot, that it be made more explicit, more user-friendly in our bylaws. And that may be the point at which, if someone wants, is going to propose a bylaw amendment, that we wind up having this discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that is what should be happening, because my memory of having been on the planning board when we proposed that and the accessory apartment bylaw, they were each taken in two phases. The accessory apartment bylaw was more strict when it was first proposed and passed, and this initial two-family was targeted at oversized vacant lots to allow for the construction of duplexes, because we also had on the books the ability to convert any house built prior to 1945 into a two-family already. So you had an ability to convert older homes into two families, and now you had an ability to build a new two-family if you had a lot that had 1.5 times the required area. The town, and for whatever reason, the planning board in the very early days of the partnership also just never went forward with trying to determine whether or not we wanted to open it even more on two families, but did on accessory apartments, which is when it was made easy, more, you could do a accessory apartment more easily than under the original bylaw. So, I mean, it is a good question. Would you want someone to be able to lay out a subdivision sort of in the opposite of a cluster? You know, a cluster allows you to have smaller than normal lots for other benefits. Would you allow oversized lots and two families in the same kind of a subdivision layout on unbuilt land? Or if you just converted, came in and acquired enough parcels to assemble a subdivision, a subdividable parcel, and create a duplex neighborhood. At the time, people were more worried about how much could this do, and how do we get the town thinking about housing variety and diversity of type and all of those things, and went only with that initial, if you own a single family freestanding lot and it has 1.5 times the area, you can build a duplex on it. If you want to have an old house, you can create it,
a duplex. So the situation that's happening now is that that was a situation that was not envisioned in the bylaw,
right?
With the tear down issue. Yeah.
Right.
So. And as a byproduct of that, we have a, you know, Bedford resident who was trying to do his due diligence to look into, by his counsel, what his options were. And our bylaw was not clear with the original intention, and there's conflicting legal opinions and conflicting. So it's an unfortunate situation that it's unclear.
Okay. So tell me again where we believe we are at this moment. What can you do and what can't you do?
Well, the town, I didn't go to the hearing either. I was asked my opinion about what the intent was. The bylaw, as it was intended, in my opinion, was that if you have an existing vacant lot that has more land area, has 1.5 times the land area for the zone in which it lies,
you are entitled to build a two-family as opposed to just a single family.
So the bylaw, as you understand it.
It refers to lots.
Requires to an empty lot.
Yes.
In which nothing previously exists. And this other law that you mentioned that was true in the past no longer exists about.
Oh, no, it does. The pre-1945 houses, that is still in the zoning bylaw.
Right, that's the conversion of an existing property.
Conversion of existing property, right.
So this, in this particular situation.
Falls in between.
Right, this was a, it was a demolition of a single-family home.
Right, on an oversized lot.
On an oversized lot and construction of a new.
When does a demolition become a vacant lot?
Well, that's a question, right?
How long does it have to sit empty?
Right, exactly.
All things for legal beagles.
So now you all know. And, you know, the next ZBA meeting that I attend, I'll certainly have a conversation. So maybe we can start this conversation.
That'd probably be a good idea. Clarity is always nice.
Just have a question, did the ZBA come to a conclusion?
The zoning board upheld the building inspector's opinion, yeah.
Yeah?
Nope, that's it.
You may have seen today the memo from the Mass Municipal Association about the progress being made in the area of statewide zoning. It sounds like something's finally going to happen, at least in the Senate. With your permission, I'd like to invite Senator Barrett to come to our next meeting and talk about that issue. We can invite the planning board, assuming that the vote isn't going to happen before our next meeting. They made it sound rather imminent, but I thought that it's an important consideration because there are certain provisions that could override local zoning and be helpful to know what they might be, how it would affect us. The agenda looks like it could handle another item.
I think that's a great idea.
It's a great idea.
Yeah, but I mean, there have been so many different versions of land use reform over the past 10 years that it's hard to know what's in and what's out at the moment.
For those interested, next Thursday in Lincoln, HATS will once again entertain the chairman of Massport. So if you don't want to go, but you have any issues that you'd like to address, I'd be glad to be the conduit to the chairman. If there's no further business, I'll entertain a motion.
Just one other quick thing I should have probably brought up earlier. I'd just like to recognize our interim public works director, Adrienne St. John. This is her last selectmen's meeting, and I want to express my appreciation for her extra effort over the last 4.5 months while she's served as interim public works director.
Thank you.
You're here.
Thank you, Adrienne.
Thank you.
Thanks for the hard work.
Your last selectman.
So we can go back to 80 hours a week now.
But you still end up coming to the selectmen's meetings anyway.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you for saluting Adrienne. So a motion to adjourn to executive session for reasons of compliance with Mass General Law requirement.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mark, seconded by Margot. All those in favor individually?
Aye.
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 Aye. 500.